I'm Tamara Baker, as Luann said. I work on the No Kid Hungry North Carolina team and have been here since we started 7 years ago. I can't believe it's been that long. A lot of familiar faces in the room, and really good news that there are a lot of new faces in the room as well. So we're just so honored, all of you who came and spent your time with us, and we hope you'll stay to the end because you're going to really want to enjoy the rest of the activities we have coming, especially this session. It's a secret, but this is going to be the best one yet. Why summer meals? I know you've been hearing a lot about things that happen at school and the breakfast program and the school lunch and the after school meals, but why summer meals? Well, I'm sure many of you in this room know. There are probably a few people who might not realize this, but those kids who are on free and reduced meals at school, or those who are in those community-eligible communities where all the meals are free, they depend on those school meals. And so what happens when summer comes around? Well, did you know that now that number of those kids we worry about is almost 1 million children? 1 million. There are only 1.5 million and change children in North Carolina. So that's a big number. More than 900,000 are now on free and reduced price meals, and then they do have a lot of brothers and sisters at home who are in need as well. So I just want to commend the fact that North Carolina now has almost 3,000 places in the summer where children can go and get free meals that are healthy and that are through the federally assisted summer nutrition programs. Cynthia's going to tell you a little bit more about those programs in a minute, but we still need, despite the fact that there are 3,000 locations, it's not nearly enough. I mean, those children, sometimes it's miles and miles between them and a place where they can go get a meal, and we know that's just, especially on those mountain roads and those dirt roads and that we all know in rural North Carolina, that's just not an option for them. So we need more places to serve meals. We need more sponsors who take on the responsibility of administering the program and taking and getting the food and taking on the financial responsibility before they then get reimbursed for the food. And we need more sites, and we need more families. I loved hearing from Orange County schools, hearing Seth talk about the need for marketing our programs. We all need more marketing. We're going to talk a little bit about that today, too. But we need your help. The summer nutrition programs in North Carolina are administered through the state agency, the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction. It used to be that there are two summer meals programs, and they were split between two state agencies, but hallelujah, they're under one agency now. It's just a little less red tape. The leader of state of summer meals, the face of summer meals, in human form, I should say, is Cynthia Ervin. And she also joining us on the stage, who will be co-presenting with us, are two food bank leaders here. We have the Mercedes Sanders with the Food Bank of Central and Eastern North Carolina, and we have Daisy Rodriguez, and you're going to hear from them. But then these other wonderful shining faces, you're going to hear a lot of information from them as well, because they're going to all have spark moments to share. But before we get into the individual discussions, we're going to give you a video to give you a visual for what a lively event for summer meals really looks like. And this one was hosted by Southeast Dairy to kick off summer meals last year, and they're now known as the Dairy Alliance, and they're all over this conference. They have been so helpful in supporting our cause and making sure that kids are getting the meals that they need. They hosted the statewide summer nutrition kickoff last June with the Carolina Panthers, a few other celebrities, and Kristen Cooper, the first lady, who was here a little earlier. And the event was a tribute to Dr. Lynn Harvey, who is DPI's nutrition leader, as you know, and it was in honor of sending her off to serve as the head of the School Nutrition Association nationally, the president of that organization. She's still in her current role, but she's taken on this very important advocacy role with that association as well, and I can't tell you how excited we are that she's in that role with all the things that need to be decided in Washington about our federal programs. But first, we're going to see this video.
Mm-hmm. And now it's my distinct pleasure to get to introduce someone that I work with on a daily basis, Dr. Lynn Harvey. She's our state director for school nutrition. But I want to tell you that Dr. Lynn Harvey is the wonder woman for school nutrition in North Carolina.
Perhaps the greatest barrier facing school nutrition programs today is that we have to understand these programs are not just about food. They're about nourishing bodies, minds, and spirits. School meals are an instructional intervention, just like a textbook, a highly qualified teacher, an outstanding facility like the one we're in today. They combine with all of the other assets in the public school system to provide children what they need to be the best they can be in the classroom. We know that when children are hungry, they can't learn. They can't focus, they can't do their best, but when they're well-nourished, they're ready to come in the classroom, they're excited, they're ready to learn, they're ready to pay attention, they are ready to give it their best today, tomorrow, and in the future.
Today is the kickoff to summer feeding for the kids in North Carolina, making sure that all kids have healthy meals throughout the summer. And it's sponsored by Fuel Up to Play 60. And I'm blessed to be able to be a part of the Panthers and be able to take part in this event. I think it's great. You know, they're trying to give access to all the kids in North Carolina to healthy food throughout the summer, but also teach them the importance of healthy eating and getting outside and playing for 60 minutes at least a day. And it's definitely near and dear to my heart. I have kids, and it's exciting just to get out here and play with them and show them, you know, you can get outside and exercise and have fun.
And I think that this program that deals with taking care of summer hunger is an issue that a lot of people are really unfamiliar with. Most people are familiar with the school lunch program, the school breakfast program, but I think a lot of people don't think about what happens to some kids who are dependent on those meals to not go hungry, and what happens in the summer when they shut down. In a place like North Carolina, where we have been blessed with so much plenty, like dairy, our milk farmers or other farmers, the problem is not that we don't have enough food, it's getting the food to where it needs to be.
Wasn't that fun? A lot of smiles on those kids' faces. It's so much fun when you see activity that's fun come together with good nutrition. So that's kind of a key for summer meals. During this session, we're gonna share more sparks of amazing work, and we're gonna highlight some of the award winners. Awards were given out that were pulled together, a program pulled together from the state agency, DPI, and the winners were announced at something called the Summer Paloozas. How many people have ever been to a Summer Palooza? Great. Summer Palooza, I love the name, just sounds like fun, and it is. These are regional meetings that DPI hosts in November, and they typically do them within a two-week period, and they go points all over the state, so they held a series of four last year. And the news is there's going to always be one near you, so we hope you'll try to make it if you're at all concerned about what happens to kids in the summertime. But some amazing people's work was highlighted, and they received awards, and those are some of the award winners you're going to hear from today. But we hope you won't miss Summer Palooza when it rolls around next year. Hopefully they're going to be having it again, right, Cynthia?
Yes.
But this year, one of the most exciting developments that happened in Summer Meals was the creation of a new and shiny, for the first time, a professional branding campaign to promote North Carolina summer nutrition for kids. Don't you just love this? Cynthia, come tell us more about this campaign.
Well, absolutely. It is my pleasure to talk about this wonderful contest that we did amongst middle and high school students across our state. So our agency, along with No Kid Hungry, worked together to host what we call a middle and high school contest, where we asked the students to design a logo, and we really just wanted a logo. But fortunately, not only were we able to get a logo, we were also able to get our mascot. And that is Ray juggling the milk and the sandwich. And Corinth High School, Johnston County Schools. Where are you, Johnston County Schools? Corinth High School is, they created both the logo and the mascot. So the great news is, as much as we talk about a lot of different champions, we serve champions. Look at the champions who came up with these designs. And many of you are champions because many of you do many things for Summer Food Service Program. How many of you do something with Summer Food Service Program? I hope everybody raised their hand. Please say yes. Well, that's great. And those of you who are not, it's your opportunity to be the champions too. So I just want to tell you guys a little bit more about the branding contest and all of that kind of stuff. And I want to show you our newest member to our team. It's a shining star, a spark of energy, electricity, and it's really excited. But hold up, I need you all to prepare first. How about if you all put on your sunglasses and you grab your flashlight, and then you gotta stand. And I'm gonna demonstrate because now you gotta do a routine with our newest member. So I'm just gonna walk you through it really quickly, and then we're gonna introduce. Okay, so really kind of simple. Three steps back, one, two, three. Three steps forward, shuffle right, shuffle left. Okay, glide to the right, glide to the left. And then you do one, two, one, two, one, two, kick, and you turn, okay? Everybody got that, right? So now that we have that and everybody's all cool and ready for this, we need some flashlights. Everybody, flashlights to the door over to the right. Drum roll, please. And there comes Ray! Woo! Everybody, flex your hands. Flash your lights. Are we ready for that step? We're gonna follow Ray's lead. Take a little break after that workout, and Ray will be back just before the break to take a picture with all of you and take your selfies. And Ray is actually gonna be available to apply to have him to come to some of your events. And so at this point, the easiest thing to do is everyone who has on a shirt like this, if you want to give them your email address and we can send you the application. Unfortunately, we may not be able to satisfy all of those, but we would love to hear whatever events that you would like to have Ray. So we're gonna give Ray a break while we continue on.
Back up.
Ray needs some space. Okay.
Is it on me?
Yes.
So, wow, how fun was that? I think it was really fun. But I'm going to have to take these off so I can see what I'm reading. So, just as the sun sets, you know, we have to give Ray a break. But again, remember, Ray will be back over in this corner to actually take pictures. So, again, as I mentioned, if you would let one of the ladies in orange know your email address, we can possibly book that. So what we want to move on to is just to show you, you just saw the picture where Ray actually has had many different photo shoots, one of which is with our state superintendent. And I think he looks like he's having a good time with Ray too, right? So Ray has also been to our school board of education, and we are making plans to go to the General Assembly in May. So we are really making our rounds with Ray. So now we want to go on and really talk a little bit more about the Summer Food Service Program. And so I'd like to actually introduce our first award winner. And this is a Seamless Summer option. So Seamless Summer is part of the National School Lunch Program, and it's exactly what it is. It's for school nutrition administrators to continue operating during the summer program, during the summer months, and doing very similar to what we have in the Summer Food Service Program. So the first sponsor is actually Clinton City Schools. And Clinton City Schools was represented by Jeff Swartz. They actually receive a Superior Site Award. Now, a Superior Site Award is actually awarded to summer meal sites that go above and beyond just the basic requirements of the program. So they look for opportunity to expand, they gain community partnerships, and they just try to go full circles. You heard whole school, whole child this morning, and this is what a superior site represents. So I'm gonna pass it over to Jeff to tell us a little about what he did.
Thank you, Cynthia. About a year ago, I received a phone call from a former assistant superintendent who retired from her ministry group called the Family Trio Ministry. And what she wanted to do was to mentor some students in their neighborhood and do something more than just feed the bellies of the students. So she targeted 62 children in their neighborhood area that they could support there in their little fellowship hall church kind of a place that their family has built. And what we did was we took the meals to them around 12 o'clock each day. The students got there a little bit earlier, and they had different lessons of self-esteem, team building, life skills. We worked with the Agriculture Extension Agency, and they came in with some speakers for nutrition education. They had games, they went on field trips. They had male support groups to kind of give them some male mentorship. And the whole point was to not just feed their stomachs, but to be able to help them to develop as young people as well, and most of the children were between the grades of like 3 and 8 or 9, ninth grade. They also got support from the United Way and some other church groups, and we used those funds that they were able to receive or donations, and they packed food boxes up for the families so those children could have food for the weekend and not feel the food insecurity that you would expect that people would have over that time period. We served 62 children during the summer, did about 800 meals during the course of the program, and this year they plan to double the site. They plan to have 125 children, and I think it was a very successful, very positive team-building mission for the group.
Very good.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, the next one that we want to talk a little bit about is the Turn Up the Beat.
Turn up for what? Turn up for what?
So our Turn Up the Beat is actually a USDA created award. And the USDA created this award for summer nutrition sponsors, both Seamless and the Summer Food Service Program, to promote their programs and offer a variety of nutritious meals through their menu. The state award is actually, we take all of those in and we look at them to see who we will forward to the federal government. So the federal government has not actually determined who they will be for this year, but we're expecting that really soon. So if you can see that in 2016, we only had four Turn Up the Beat nominees and they all won. And we had four, two of which were gold, one silver, and one bronze. So we did an amazing job nationally. So we're really anxious to get our results back from the 13 to see where we are with those. So basically, the next person that I'm gonna introduce you to was not only a Turn Up the Beat winner, she also was a rising star and a superior sight. So I'm gonna turn it over to Stephanie Workman of Kirk of Kildaire Presbyterian Church.
Thank you, Cynthia. So we were a first-time site this summer, a sponsor. We ran two additional sites. In total, there were four churches working together, one providing volunteers, and that was Christ the King Lutheran. But then the Kirk of Kildaire and Cary Presbyterian and Greenwood Forest Baptist all joined together for 10 weeks. We served between 70 and 100 children plus their parents 4 days a week for 10 weeks. While we're in Cary, North Carolina, which is a fairly wealthy suburb, we serve a population of poverty. About 80% of our folks are Latino. And so in addition to being food insecure, if they didn't have our program, they wouldn't hear English for the entire summer. They wouldn't have a book read to them. And so that was a huge need. Of our school-age kids, 94% were eligible for free and reduced lunch. And so we ended up serving 3,705 lunches to the children, in addition to their parents, some of whom were pregnant, so feeding the next generation as well. So we got input from those families. I'm obviously not Hispanic, so I don't know what Hispanics like. So we went to our ESL class and asked, what would you like to eat? What do you not want to eat? We made some things are very simple, like don't put ice in the water, put paprika on the chicken. So there's some simple things like that, but then we also chose entrees that would meet their needs. We tried to stay authentic, so no cheddar cheese on tacos, which was surprising to me. And they loved fresh fruits and vegetables, so we went through tons of fresh fruits and vegetables. As for the program component, every day there was from 9:30 to 12:30. So we had a separate preschool program with dedicated teachers, a separate middle school program and an elementary program, and a program for the adults. The adults, we said, what do you want to learn? And they came up with lots of life skills, nutrition, and we worked with the extension office, first aid, exercise, knitting, some additional ESL classes, and some parenting classes. So some of the other programs, other things we incorporated, we have a community garden. So we actually got the kids out there working in the garden. And then that garden, so like the jalapenos, for instance, that we grew became part of the taco bar, for instance. We also got fresh fruit from the St. Andrew's Society, 310 pounds of corn, which was really fun to do something with. But we served it and sent it home, which was great. And one of the things we found to be very successful was since the children's native language, most of them is Hispanic or Spanish, we asked the moms to serve on the line so that they could actually speak with the kids in their native language, which was very helpful. Even though our families live close to the church, and our three churches are located within 2 miles of each other, so even though they are very close, transportation was still very important. And so every day there were at least three vehicles, and we wrote a grant and got another vehicle for this year to be able to pick up the kids and the families and get them to the churches. Particularly in the heat of the summer or when it's raining, that just we would not work without it. We learned a whole lot about preferences. That was very important. We also learned, like, green beans, they do not like it out of the can. They like it fresh. So as much as we could, we tailored it. Families also got a bag every week, and the parents got to go shopping in our food pantry area for what met their family's needs. So in the end, as she mentioned, we had three awards, and we were happy to do it and thrilled to do it again this summer.
So there you have it, a brand new sponsor for the first year ever. So you can do it too. So she not only served the children in the meal, she actually addressed the whole family and all the different needs. And that is amazing, and thank you so much. So we now see why she got three awards last year. So now we want to just talk a little bit about the data. So everyone's, this map is actually over at the table, but this map is basically developed with the help of No Kid Hungry and their team. But basically what they do is they take the data and they look at how many eligible children are in each county. And based on July data, we compare that to how many children are actually getting the meals. And just really quickly, all I can say about this map is there's too many in the 5 to 10 and 0 to 4%. So we need, it is our goal to move past that, only serving a fourth. You know, we want to get above serving only less than a fourth of your children. So look at your county, grab one to take with you, and see how can you make an impact. And there are many people around this, in this room, in your county that's already doing work. Look for opportunities to join with them so that we can expand. So these are our goals for 2018. So this year, what we really want to do, if you were a sponsor last year, we want to figure out how we can retain sponsors. So we cannot expand this program unless we actually bring sponsors on, keep them on, and have them to develop and become more proficient so that they can grow and serve more meals. And then we want to see everyone to look at where they were last year and how can they add 25 more meals daily, whether that is per site or per your whole sponsorship. How can you figure out how to serve those? It might require more marketing, more outreach. And then, and additionally to that, you know, schools are out somewhere between 52 to 60 days during the summer. On average, our state last year, we served about 13 days. So we need to really focus on how can we expand. And keep in mind, these students in school get meals 9 months out of the year. They are out close to 3 months. 13 days is not enough. We need to try to serve them within that whole 52, but we're just saying merely start with 5 additional days, but everyone has to look for ways to do that. And so we're encouraging you to do that. And of course, this year we had 13 Turn Up the Beat nominees. Next year we want to have even more. So it would be great to have 20, but I just said, let's just increase that number by 10%. So let's plan that for next year. So this just basically shows you our total meals that we serve across the state. I would say for the first time since 2015, we had a slight drop in the number of meals that we served this year. There's many different factors that went into that, but we are definitely gearing up this year for a more expansive year. This year we added a new tool called a pre-screen tool. And I think the staff and I are all shaking in our boots because we have about 45 new potential sponsors working in that tool right now. And typically we've been bringing in about 5 to 10. So we have a huge interest in operating the program this summer.
Great problem.
A great problem to have. So again, this just breaks it down on how many meals we serve per program, but totally it was more than 5 million meals that we did all summer long last summer. So give yourselves a hand because you were the one to make that happen.
SSO versus.
Yeah.
SSO.
And then if you look at SSO, of course they did almost 1 million, and then the rest of them came from the summer food service program.
And the SSO is the summer is the program that school food authorities only can mm-hmm. can serve. She may have already mm-hmm. said that.
Okay. Is that me? Uh-huh. All right. Well, we have a new tool, and that's also over at our table. We So once we looked at all the counties, we decided to rank each county based on their percentage of the, how many children they serve. So we have actually ranked everyone. And if you would notice here, then we have New Hanover is highlighted. That is actually, they are the 21st. They serve the 21st most children that are eligible in their area. So we would recommend that you take that. That's a great talking tool for officials, for elected officials, or even your leadership to talk about how can you make that a make a difference in your county. And then this one is amazing. If that is not enough talking tool, we now have the county profile. So that's everything you need to know about summer meals. There is information that actually tells you how much percentage you served of your needy children, how many were not served, and basically it will tell you about how many sponsors and just a wealth of information that you can find. Now those can be found on the No Kid Hungry website. And you are free to choose those and pull them down and use them at your leisure. And let us know if you have any questions. I would want to just let you all know that the data that we are talking about is really focused on the July month, because I've already heard someone say, well, I operated, but mine is not there. But we focus on the July month because that is the user month where we have the majority of organizations running. So if you're not currently operating in July, your information may or not may not be accounted for.
Is it true that USDA also uses that month to measure?
That's what USDA uses, yes, to account for their make. So Jessica Sotavini, a doctoral student for the UNC Chapel Hill, and she's also on the No Kid Hungry team. She led this effort to come up with these great profiles, including, and you know, they all talk about basically all the information that you would need to know as you are beginning to talk about programs in your area.
And Jessica and her team not only developed these profiles county by county, individual county, specifically on summer nutrition programs served in your county, but they also developed one based on each school district on breakfast and school breakfast. So it can very quickly you can say, oh, I see our school district is serving 35% of its need, or I see that we are number 90 on the list in summer in the state, and it gives you some important talking points. Okay.
Okay. So, speaking and of New Hanover County, another spark. So, we have someone else who also, they actually were definitely one of the summer nutrition sponsors that turned it up. And they received another Turn Up the Beat Award. So we're gonna turn it over to Imer of New Hanover County Schools to talk about her experience.
Thank you, Cynthia. Greetings from New Hanover County. That's in Wilmington, North Carolina. We have 27,000 students. We feed about 18 to 19,000 a day, 39% free and reduced. We have 21 out of 43 schools, we have 21 CEP schools. And you've heard that lingo here at the conference, so we're very proud of that. I think with summer food service, it comes dear to my heart because I was a student at UNCG, a dietetic intern, and I was offered a job. I was like, wow, I can be an intern and get paid for it. So I ended up getting a food service minor as a minor, and I was able to get paid for it. And I got to do the summer food service program in Guilford County. And I fell in love with it. I mean, wow, what a time. I mean, you actually get to go out into the community, meet people, meet the children, meet their families, see where they live, talk to them. And then on top of that, you actually can correlate some education with it. You can correlate some physical activity. And I won't talk too long, Andrea, I'm sorry, but I could babble on for a long time, but it comes dear to my heart. As you can see, in 2016, we had 23 sites. We fed over 35,000 meals, 31 days of service, but Cynthia always encourages us to increase. So last summer we did 29 sites, 38,000 meals, 40 days of service. So I applaud my staff because they are just awesome. I'm very high energy. I love what I do, truly from the heart. Mi madre es de Colombia, so she, un poquito español. I know she speaks a little Spanish. No. But my mom always told me that food is love. Food comes from the heart. She spoke very little English, and she fed so many families that, you know, she taught me that food is a love language and it can talk, and all you got to do is smile and it means it can go so far. So that's what I do every day. I go in with a smile, thank you, and I try to show my love of what I do. But summer food service, this summer, Cynthia, we are already looking at increasing our days, looking at new sites. Kind of like I like to shoot a little high, you know. but you know, summertime right now, I don't know with the other directors, but we are working. Like tomorrow, I've got a meeting with school officials, with partners, with ESL, with third grade reading people, with kindergarten fast start, with other groups, and we're coming together tomorrow, and we are brainstorming how can we reach more children this summer. What can we do? And I'm very excited about it. So those are my numbers last year. Ideas to increase participation. We added on our menu. As a dietitian, I'm always looking at color, creativity on the menu. Is it easy for the kids to handle? I know one speaker said that kids, you know, if you don't like something, they won't. No. You introduce food items to children. Research shows, you know, at least 10 to 12 times. Children will take it. You have to, it's the way that you present it and introduce it to children. They will take it. You know, we do have some, you know, try it. But we do have some children that are very picky. But it's amazing. I don't know if it's other directors. I hear parents all the time saying, my child, you know, loves your lima beans, you know, but then I find out they've never had it before. So what, I mean, I'm just so pleased that other child nutrition directors and schools that we're able to introduce lots of food items. So we do offer more kid-friendly items. We do look for new areas. I did work with, we have a wonderful university, if anybody wants to come, University of North Carolina at Wilmington. And I worked with the sociology department, and I had a student there, and do you know she's at UNC right now getting her MPH? I'm so proud of her. But she worked on a study for me to show me what areas am I missing? Where am I? She's a sociology major. She got into it. I introduced her to child nutrition. We also encourage nutrition education. We always have some other, I had a reading group there. I had the police department, I had the sheriff department come and educate kids. I had dental hygienists come and talk about dental health. I had other dietitians come and talk about food and just the different varieties of food. You know, kids love crunchy foods or soft foods, and you got to introduce a variety of foods to kids. So we did a lot of nutrition education. We did public PR announcements. I tried to use every avenue that I could to get the word out to the community. Menus. We also introduced with this Turn Up the Beet Award, we you know, wanted to make sure that we offered fresh fruits and vegetables, make sure that we had whole grains on the menus, make sure that milk, you know, we met the milk requirements that are needed, fat-free, low-fat. And we also, what else did we do? But we did a lot of neat things in the county. Please, if you ever want to come visit New Hanover County Schools, just give me a call. I'll be more than happy to show you our sites, come out. If you're interested in what we do, you know, in child nutrition, I would love to talk to you about that. If you're looking for a job, let me know. I love child nutrition. So I wear a lot of hats. I wear a lot of hats. But anyway, I'm gonna stop there. But call me if you want to talk more. I'd love to talk about it.
Let's see what she turned it up.
Imer is a ball of energy. I love it. Love it. Thank you so much. A big focus this year, and Imer really sort of set the stage for what I'm about to say, is this is
February. I mean, it's a nice day today, but there's still some cold days. And a lot of people are thinking, why are you talking about summer meals? But the big focus this year was for us to think about and to try to reset people's frame of reference. Summer meals is a year-round program. It is. It requires planning and coordinating and advance marketing. And if you don't start your marketing and start forming your partnerships early on, that's why we have the summer paloozas, for you to come and reset right then, get all excited, get fired up. And this year we created this tool. Yes, it is loud, but it's based on the logo that was created by that artistic student in Johnson County. And it is big, and it's in a plastic sleeve. It's meant for you to carry with you all the time to your meetings. And in blue are program things that you have to do every single month. And in orange are promotional things you need to be thinking about, partnerships and promotions and marketing. And it really tries to be a tutorial with lots and lots of websites that tell you exactly where to go and find these materials. So we have lots of these in the back. We encourage you to take them. Get one for every member of your team that is working on summer meals. And together, sit down and brainstorm ideas. It's a monthly checklist as well as a guide to light the path so that you are much more likely to be successful. I was so excited when I heard someone say that in Orange County the other day, is Valerie in here, that they were taking it to meetings. Did I hear that right, Valerie? You're showing up at meetings and they're going down their checklist. And I hope it's helpful. That's exactly why it was designed. All of these pieces that we're showing today and the things that you see everywhere, we have all the giveaways and the marketing materials, especially banners and posters, that sort of thing. We have created the files and put them on our website and even given you links to where you can buy them at affordable prices. We're pretty good shoppers, and we've figured out how to make some of these tools a little bit more accessible. So I encourage you to go to our Summer Meals section of our website. It's on all your materials. You can't really miss the address of the website. I was excited to talk to you about year-round for another reason, too. There's an example in the room here and up here on the stage of leadership commitment to year-round meals for kids. Our next guest who's going to speak is a principal. He makes sure his students get school breakfast, lunch, and after-school meals at school. And he's committed to summer nutrition as well. And as soon as I met him, I knew I liked him because he had that spark. You know, he didn't need a flashlight and some electric bulbs on the table. He already had that spark. So he's going to bring that enthusiasm in just a minute here. But three healthy meals a day, that's what I need every day. That's what our children need every day, no matter whose children they are. So what a great concept, and we're just really excited when we see people who are going after it with gusto. So let's hear from Principal Marvin Moore at Isenberg Elementary in Salisbury, and a shout out to Rowan-Salisbury for making this happen. You guys are really on the ball with summer meals, and we so appreciate it.
Come on, y'all can do better than that. It's 2:30 on a Thursday afternoon, right? You can do better than that. First of all, I'd like to say thank you to everybody. I was sitting down. I can't do it. I'm an elementary principal, ex-PE teacher, former college coach. I cannot. I was killing me to sit down that long. I'm ready to go do something different. These numbers are basically just numbers about what we do in our school. We run around 69% of our kids come through breakfast a day. We all know the research about it. We're doing the best we can every day to make sure kids are getting their breakfast. And some of the kids, I make sure they go through twice. I'm just going to be real honest with you. Nobody's going to eat it. Go get that breakfast from your buddy down the street. Let's get this food to these babies. They need to eat. Let's understand. We get that. The second part of the average daily lunch. Our kids, 87% of them getting it from the cafeteria every day. but what I will say is we all know the truth of this. These numbers matter only because our kids matter the most. We got to make sure that we are intentional about making sure they get what they need while they're in class. If we're not doing it, shame on us. The average daily school participation, that's after-school stuff that we do, and that number is not right. That number came before we started our after-school program. And the saying goes, if you feed them, they'll come. Right? Say it with me. If you feed them, they'll come. If you feed them, they'll come. Most of you guys came today because you knew it was going to be some good food. Let's just be real honest, right? If you feed them, they'll come. We wanted to make sure our kids are doing things. So after school, I tell our staff, if you're going to work with our kids, you can work with our kids every day, all day. They're on your mind. You need to be with them. So we tell the parents, if we provide an opportunity for them, I'm also feed them. That should not be an opportunity that I'm giving that you won't take. They're going to eat while they're with us. So we do after-school clubs. We do after-school tutoring. We do Saturday schools. Our kids get that on a daily basis. And that number went from 58 in the first week of it. Last week on Tuesday and Thursday was 107 both days, right? And it's going to keep going up because I'm going to tell the parents I'm going to feed them on Saturdays as well. Does that make sense? Can I get an amen?
Amen?
My baby told me this morning, she said, Daddy, are you going to be walking around? Because that's a nice suit you got on. I said, baby, I am, right? Check this video out. This is our kids. Actually, our kids created this video for us. And this is our fresh fruit and vegetables program that we have in our district. But in our school, we take full advantage of it. The first time our RSS people tell us, Mr. Moore, we got a new initiative you want to do, bring it to us. My kids need to eat. My kids come to us. We are 88% free and reduced lunch. And a lot of that number is free. You got free and you got free and reduced. Most of ours are free. My babies need to have it. So fresh fruits, we need to make sure they get it three times a day. After school tutoring, they get this food in the afternoons. Our ladies take this food out and they prepare it every morning for our kids. During the summer, our school district, shout out to Dr. Moody, who's a wonderful superintendent. She bought into the vision and it starts at the top. We can all say it. We created a bus. It's called a Yum Yum bus. We take that bus out through the school's district and we ride that bus, not only the kids, adults, people who work in our district. If you're a leader, you gotta lead by example. Get on the bus, go see where our kids live, sit in there with them, let the kids eat, and you'll see exactly what happens. Oftentimes, we're trying to teach people we don't know. You can't do that. You can't do it effectively. So if you don't know them, you're lying to yourself and to the kid, and they can see it, right? So get to know your kids, get to know where they live. That's what we do during the summer. That's a part of our after-school program. We also had a fresh fruits and vegetables I told you a few seconds ago. After-school dinner, that's what we do. And quality lunch and breakfast. We have a great staff that do a lot of things for our kids, but most and foremost, we put our money where our mouth is. We put it where it is. So if we're gonna say we're gonna raise for grants and things and it's very important for our district, they know it. If I look at your checking account right now today, I can tell what matters most to you, right? I can tell. So if you're not doing what you're seeing on the screen right now, you can't tell me food means a lot to our kids if you're not doing these kinds of things. The data that they've been showing us all day today is about how important breakfast is, how important it is for our kids to eat. They're food insecure. We have to be vigilant about this thing, making sure academics is a part of what we do, but we all know if they're hungry, they can care less about what you're feeding them as far as academics. It's natural. They have to be fed. They have to be fed on a daily basis. And they gotta make sure that you know that you care, right? I go into our cafeteria every day and I promise you, my kids will tell you, my teachers will get up and say, Mr. Moore, you causing disruption. I know. But if they're not hugging you the way they're hugging me, you got a problem. That's not my problem, that's yours. I'm with them half the time, you with them all the time. They should love you way more than they love me, right? So let's make sure we do what we know to be true. I got a couple of, just a couple of quick things I want to share with you, and I promise you I'll get out of your hair because it's almost Friday. For some of us, it's already Friday, right? But I want to make sure we understand this point, and we got to make sure we do. We have to beat, and we got to be the intentional change that we want everybody to know. So let's make sure we create the narrative. We create it. It's so many times across this country, the education is getting dogged out about whatever it is, right? There are several good things going on in all these counties, but we're not controlling the narrative. We have to do that. Market what you're doing in your schools. Make sure people know what's happening in your community. You create that narrative. What you create, people will buy. If you allow other people to talk about what you're doing in your district without doing it yourself, shame on you. You create that narrative. You have it. So it's Twitter. It's social media. It's whatever you're doing. Take pictures. Put it out there. Make people understand that everything about schools and what you're doing for food and nutrition is not bad. A lot of things are wonderful, but people don't know about it, right? Everybody get that? That's your job. That's not just your principal's job or your superintendent's job. That's your job as a parent, as a teacher, as a school food service. That's your job to do that. Because when it all boils down, it's for our kids, right? I can't hear you.
Yes.
All right. Next time I say that, if you don't do it right, we're doing push-ups. All right? The next thing we're going to talk about real quickly is in our school, guys, we do a lot of stuff. I'm being funny when I say it, but I'm passionate about my babies. I love them. But we make sure I'm on a program. I said, if you can't beat them, join them. I didn't know where most of the money was in our district. I had no clue how that stuff was happening. So what I did, I said, you know what, I'm going to sit back and watch where this money going. I'm going to get on some of these boards, right? So I got on Food for Thought. So now my kids get backpacks every weekend. About 60 of my kids every weekend are getting food for thought book packs, backpacks. And then I saw, you know, if it's my kid doing it, every other kid should be able to get it. So then we could help. Now, I didn't do it myself. I'm not saying I did it, but I'm on the board to help. And before you know it, there are several different backpack programs in our county that's sending bags home to kids. It started in elementary. Now we got a lot of high school kids getting the same things. So we got to make sure we're part of that narrative. And then the other thing I want to talk to you guys about is be courageous. You get a leader, you got to be courageous. Real leaders are the ones that have the courage to break up the routines that have been created by low expectations. Real leaders are the ones that create the narrative and change and have the courage to change the systems and the routines that's created by low expectations. Trust me, low expectations will kill you. Trust me, if you keep doing these low expectations, the saddest thing about low expectations is that you hit it. So put the expectation high, and if you don't get the goal you wanted to hit, at least you went higher than where you were yesterday. But don't put that expectation out there so low that you're afraid to do what you know you're supposed to do, especially if it's for your kids. It's our kids we're talking about getting right. If food is what we need to make sure we do, make sure they're not food insecure across the board. Let's keep doing what we know to be true. Thank you so much for letting me be here. I will tell my daughter I wore this suit and I wore it well today. Y'all have a great day.
Was I right? He brings the spark. Thank you so much. Wow, I'm inspired. It's really an honor to hear from you, Principal. We know principals are so critical in this equation. And how many times have I heard people say, but our principal just does not want this program. We need about 1,000 more of Principal Moores out there. So how are your evangelical skills?
Here we go.
All right, we'll work on that strategy next. But we're going to hear next from our spotlight co-partners with us in this conference. We're going to hear about the vital role of food banks in summer nutrition. And I learned really quickly when I started working in this space, you know, now several years ago, that the food banks who are involved in the federal nutrition programs are really involved. And we applaud these two food banks you're going to hear from today because they go the extra mile to participate as sponsors. When I first met them, they were doing this size, and you know, very quickly they were going this scope of the scale of the numbers of sites and the number of kids that they were feeding. So they're not afraid to take on an expansive scale in providing summer nutrition to the kids. But what's so critical is by accessing those federal dollars, they feed thousands more kids in the summertime than they would if they just relied on donations from the public. And so they recognize that. And so the fact that they partner with so many other organizations, and if you've heard that, I will partner with you. They mean that seriously. So take them up on it. They already were, but have really become experts in these federal programs. And what they don't know, they're eager to learn. So I just want to first let us hear from Mercedes Sanders, who is going to tell us about their work. And what's remarkable about her work at the Food Bank of Central and Eastern North Carolina is not only do they serve the summer food service program, but they have started in a big way in at-risk after-school meals, served through this federally assisted program called the At-Risk After-School Meals Program. But before she comes up, I just want to do a really quick shout-out. Is Karen Lanez Ruby, would you stand up? Get to know this face. Karen is a bright spot. She is a spark of enthusiasm at Department of Health and Human Services working on the At-Risk After School Meals program. She's a consultant for that program, and she is happy to take your questions about how you too can become a sponsor. And it may be there may be difficult waters to navigate, but she's going to try to help you as much as she can. And so partner with Karen and talk with her. We want to have a bit much bigger focus next year, hopefully, about the success of that At-Risk After School Meals program, thanks to Karen's commitment to this work. Now we want to hear from Mercedes, if you'll come up.
Well, I'll
you
stay
can
right
stay
here.
There. You can stay there. Yes. She wants to stay there.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Tamara, Cynthia, Karen.
for all you do to assist the food bank with our federal child nutrition programs. I am Mercedes Sanders, as they said, and I have the privilege of supervising the Summer Food Service Program and the at-risk after-school meals programs for the Food Bank of Central and Eastern North Carolina. And I'd like to share with you guys today an overview of the food bank's participation in these federal child nutrition programs. So as Tamara mentioned, not only are we a leader in the summer nutrition, but for the last 2 years, we've been a sponsor for the Child and Adult Care Food Program at-risk after-school meals. We've grown our program from just two sponsors in the first year to six sites to date, and we have plans to add a few more before the end of this school year. Participating as an at-risk after-school meals program sponsor has allowed us to transition summer meal sites to this program in order to provide year-round service, as well as expand our privately funded Kids Cafe programs, which traditionally can be limited but because they're based on private donor funding, as well as geographically they may be limited due to that funding. With only one after-school meal or snack served for every 10 school lunches being served across the country, according to Share Our Strength, we plan to continue our growth and expansion of the after-school meal sponsorship. I want to encourage you all to get more information about these programs and network with the people here today to help close the gap by serving after-school meals. Now, the same kind of gap exists during the summer. This year marks the Food Bank's 10th year as a Summer Food Service Program sponsor. We have been diligently working to close the gap on summer hunger. And as you can see by the slides and the charts, we have seen tremendous growth over the years. We've grown to become the state's largest nonprofit sponsor for summer meals. And in the summer of 2007, as Cynthia mentioned a little earlier, our state saw a decline in summer meals participation. So as the state's largest sponsor, we also felt the effect of that. But even still, we were able to sponsor 138 meal sites. We served over 6,500 children, more than 190,000 meals.
Wow.
So I would say that's a large chunk.
Yes.
Out of that gap that exists between those people, those children that are in need and those that are actually being served. Just imagine the families of the nearly 60% of all North Carolina public school children who receive free or reduced lunch. Having to think about what to do during the summer to overcome the struggles that just may come from not being able to get those two meals every day. Now, some of you may have started to think as I was talking, what can I do or what can my organization do to try to help close this hunger gap for the children at risk of hunger over the summer or after school, or strengthen the programs that you already have in place? Ask yourself the questions on the screen. Consider community partnerships. If you're in a rural area, how do you transport the children to your summer meal sites? I was talking a little earlier with Miss Ophelia. I work very closely with her as the food lady, and she was telling me how she wants to figure out how to transport more kids to summer sites, how to go to them. You have to be really creative when you start thinking about these summer meals program because they're congregate feeding sites. That means they have to eat where they are. And the best thing about it is you can be flexible and take the food to where they are and set up a congregate site there. So in order to add more meals or add more days, consider adding a snack or meal to your existing program if you may only provide one meal or snack that's reimbursable. Or add in a weekend meal. Just imagine a Saturday or Sunday meal that you provide to a kid that's already in need could tremendously help a family. A lot of times you think, you know, Monday through Friday service because that's how we traditionally work. But as a lot of us talked about today, these weekends are very tough for people. So in these programs, you do have the flexibility to provide meals on the weekend, as Mr. Moore said that he does at his school. So consider becoming a mentor, as I have, on behalf of the food bank to provide assistance to meal sites to help them grow, start up new meal sites, or even if you know an organization or your organization yourself may have the capacity to become a sponsor. The state agencies, you've seen the representative from DHHS here today and the state agency from DPI, all of their representatives have been here today. They are very helpful with answering questions about setting up sites, how to become a sponsor, And organizations like the food banks are also here to help. Tamara mentioned it, and we really do mean it when we say that we can help you guys, we can talk through things with you guys. We're here to serve and make these programs grow as best as we can and have them to be sustainable. Just consider pushing your limits, be open-minded about the partnerships that you may be able to come up with in your communities. Every community is gonna be different. But the whole goal and my goal as I continue to move forward with what I do at the food bank is to expand and grow sustainable summer meals and after school meal sites, especially for these federal child nutrition programs. So thank you for your time and listening to me today. My contact information is on the screen. I do have my business card and my manager's information is on the screen as well. We are really here to help you guys with these programs. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mercedes, for sharing. Next, we're going to hear from Daisy Rodriguez, and she is, of course, with Second Harvest Food Bank of the Northwest, North Carolina, and she's going to give us an overview, and she's going to tell you about a partnership. We know that partnerships are critical links, and she's going to tell us about one that's pretty great, and then we're going to pretty soon wrap up after that, and there's food at the break.
Yay. Well, thank you, Tamara. Hello, everybody. This is so exciting. I am thrilled to not only be sitting here with such exciting panelists, but also with all of you, because you're all champions, and we're all champions in feeding children. Mercedes said a lot of things that I'm not going to repeat, because food banks are out there to feed people. That is our mission. So how we go about it is different, and she mentioned being creative. So let me just tell you how we got involved, because Cynthia will remember this. In 2009, my childhood hunger program consisted of me, myself, and I. And my ED decided that, hey, maybe we should talk about summer meals. And I said, sure, let's do that. We were already doing backpack. We were doing kids cafe, so it makes sense. Let's feed kids during the summer. So I went to a training, met Cynthia, and I said, wow, this is huge, and that application process is really daunting. However, here we are 9 years later. We're a sponsor. We became a sponsor in 2010. We were excited about the fact that we were able to take the plunge. You know, fear prevents people from doing a lot of things. Don't ever be fearful. You have help. You've got great team, the SFSP team, Cynthia and her team, they're awesome. There has not been a day that we don't call, my team and I call, and they're there, they're available to answer any question you may have. But we started small, and I always tell folks, yes, you want to feed thousands of children, you'll get there, but start small. So you heard from Roderick Howard, the YMCA. We reached out to the YMCA and we said, hey, you got kids during the summer, we've got food, how about we do something? And our first four sites were all YMCA sites. So you've got some really great partners in your community that you can start with or even just expand with. So they've been our partner. They continue to be our partner. We went from four sites in one county, because we serve 18 counties, to 27 sites last year and serving six counties. So we're expanding. Yes, we're excited. Couldn't have done this by myself. I love my team. They are amazing. All of my colleagues that are sitting over there, they're amazing people. We have actually just done incredible things, thinking of new ways to feed kids. And I'll tell you this, we started feeding 195 kids in 2010. We fed over 2,200 last summer.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Great.
And we fed them breakfast and lunch, most of the sites, and breakfast was not something we wanted to do. We took the plunge 2 years ago when we took all of the parks and recs from Greensboro, and they needed to be fed breakfast and lunch. So again, you have to think, what can I do? What's your capacity? I mean, you don't want to be overwhelmed and not feed kids, but you have to think, what is it that we can do? My team and I, we sit down, and the one phrase that always comes about is feed the babies. We got to feed the babies, and that means working together. It's a collaboration. You hear that word a lot. We live it. It is part of our strategic plan also. So we are attempting to add more sites and more meals. So just know that you're making a difference. You may not know this. You may never see that child you're feeding, but you are making a difference. You're giving them food. You are showing them that somebody cares, but you're giving them hope. So thank you for what you do, and we are available to answer questions and help you along. Yes, we'll mentor, won't we, Mercedes? We will mentor, definitely. Thank you, and I want to introduce you to another Superior Site Award recipient. My Ted Grunset is the Director of Nutrition for the Forsyth County Department of Health, the WIC office, and this was our first public open site. So talk about fear. We had closed enroll for all of 8 years, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, public, I don't know how many meals we need. But they were amazing, and I'm going to let her talk about the fact that she fed kids that came through the WIC office. My dear.
Thank you, Daisy. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me here. It's really a pleasure and honor. Doing this project was so excited, and I'm going to stick to the slides so that way we can all go and eat, you know, a break. So how did it all start? It's interesting because it came through a email through Kathy, which was Katie.
Katie,
who was a child, I think you took the sub-nutrition consultant, right? And she said, I went to Florida, the WIC program there was doing this. I said, who wants to do it? So she opened it up for all the WIC programs mm-hmm. in the state. And so, you know, for those that are not very familiar with the WIC program, you know, this is the special supplemental nutrition program for women, infants, and children that we serve children up to the age of 5. So when she, you know, emailed this, I said, Summer, you know, summertime, for some reason, you know, we have all the neighborhood in WIC, okay? Mm-hmm. Parents bring the entire kids that are in the household and the neighbor's household. So, you know, with that many people, you know, it just makes sense, you know, to do something, you know, for the children that are there sometimes, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours waiting. So, Katie said, okay, you want to do it? I said, I want to do it. I will, you know, guide you to the right person. And indeed she did. She put me in contact with Daisy. Daisy said, whatever you need, we are here. We want to partner. We want to make it successful. And she gave us so much support. It was incredible. Her staff, you're right, it's amazing. You know, I've never felt, by myself, you know, anytime I have a question, I had a doubt, they were there. And if I couldn't go, they were coming to me. I mean, they were not gonna let me, you know, go by with an excuse. So that's how we all started. We partnered. Then the next step was to convince my health director, my staff, right, and the health department staff. So how was I gonna do that? I went to, first of all, I have to say I have an amazing health director. You know, when you have people that are passionate, it's so much easier. You know, so you just go there and said, Mr. Hunter, this is what's happening. We have everything ready. I said, can we do it? Right away. You have the rooms, whatever it takes, make it happen. We want to feed children at the health department. So with that blessing, I approached my staff. Now, some of you have said, oh, I have the, you know, the best staff in the county, the best staff in the state, the best staff in, you know, the nation. Well, I have the best staff in the world. Okay? So with them, my nutritionists were all into it. They were ready to plan. You know, we had to set up the times. We have to set up the days. We didn't know, you know, any of this because we're an open site. Have no idea how many kids were gonna show up. We had no idea how to do the marketing, and we came in a little bit late, you know, in the year to start doing like a lot of marketing to begin with. So You know, we set the dates, we reserve all the rooms, some rooms were taken, we kicked them out because we needed the room, you know, all the conference rooms. So I looked at who serves about the same population that we serve at the health department in WIC. So we are located right next to social services, which is very convenient, right? And we also have a partnership. We have a satellite clinic at the downtown Health Plaza, which is kind of like a community agency, health agency, that serves, you know, quite a lot of our clients. So with them on board, I told them, you know, what we were doing. We needed their promotion. You know, they email their doctors. You know, social services email all their case managers. So we were all ready for this. My nutritionists were taking turns, you know, in terms of who was going to be with the children, who was going to get trained. You know, six of my nutritionists were able to get trained. And once we decided to do it, we had everything in place. The day came. Daisy gave us something that I found really, really helpful. There were some cards. You know, sometimes we pass so many nutrition education pamphlets around, you know, you find them everywhere. You know, it's just like, how effective are those things, you know? So I didn't want to create another pamphlet. So those cards, I said, well, they're kind of hard, you know, durable. So on the back, we made labels with the dates, English and Spanish, you know, the dates, the times, and who were, you know, eligible for that. So we passed it to every single family that came across to WIC, every single family that came into the health department. And we did that very aggressively, like the day before we were gonna serve the meals and the day off. And that's how we really feel that it worked. Now, the days that we picked were Tuesday and Fridays. And you might think, well, Fridays, nobody's gonna come. But Fridays were really busy. Actually, we had sometimes up to 25 kids, you know, on a Friday. So what we did, the days that we were slow, we will go, because you see in social services, in and out families like crazy, right? Now in the health department, not so many. So we were at the window watching all those families going to social services. And like, you know, we got food here. So my nutritionist actually went to social services and started getting all the moms with their kids, you know, come on, we have food in here, you know, come on here. So once they came, you know, we talked to them, we make them feel welcome, you know, part of it, you know, that it was an honor for us to have them in there. That's how we wanted to, for them to feel, you know, this is really an honor. We're so glad, so happy, you know, talking to the kids about, you know, what do you like about your meal? What do you don't like about your meal? What you wish you had, you know, things like that. So you get ideas. The buy-in with the health department was important because you not only have children, you have the parents. And the parents may be hungry as well. So you cannot serve the parents' meals. So the health department staff donate cereal bars, they donate granola bars, they donate money to buy fresh fruit. We had a bunch of snacks. So while the kids were eating their lunches, the parents could be eating something as well. We also prepare little brown bags for them to take with the food that was donated by the health department, and also with education in there. We had coloring books for the children. We had little stickers, and you know, they took their juice, their what else we had, apples, their cereal balls, the applesauce, all the stuff that the health department had, you know, added to that lunch. We also had the table set up in a restaurant style. You know, we put tablecloths and we had flowers in every table. Okay, so we really wanted to make them feel proud. You know, and we have music, and we made them talk. Because sometimes they will just come in here and they will just eat, you know. So you sit with them, you say, where are you from, you know. They will say, oh, you have a funny accent. I said, well, I'm glad I make you funny, you know, it's funny. You know, that's good. know, they will say, where are you from? You know, I say, I'm from the South. And I'll look at, really? And say, yeah, I'm from Chile. That's the real South. All right. So, you know, so stuff like that. So you create that
relationship. Excitement?
Relationship. Exactly. And they keep coming. Mm-hmm. You know, and then it's just not longer like they feel ashamed or embarrassed. You know, they like to come. So we served 6 weeks. It was about 6 weeks, right? Mm-hmm. 6 weeks, twice a week, we were able to serve 247 meals.
Wow, that's great.
We also, at the same time, we found out about the backpack program. So mm-hmm. we had lots of families on Fridays, you know, that they will express to us that they didn't have enough food. So we were able to give these backpacks to family, and we were able to give 40 of those out to them. So once the program ended, most of the staff felt so empowered. You know, to do this again, you know, this time my staff is just so ready. They can't wait, you know. Definitely things that we have learned is, of course, we're going to do more marketing. You know, we are continuing our great partnership with Daisy and her staff. Continue involving other partners. One thing that I did that it helped with social services is you don't tell them one time one thing. You tell them every week what's happening, every single week what's happening, and you send people over there to tell them. You know, this is happening right now, today. Send them, you know. So it really takes that extra step, it does, to make it happen.
We're going to have to stop pretty soon because we have a guest coming back who is probably dancing on his little tippy toes, big tippy toes. But I just want to thank you. There are very few WIC offices in the state, very few social services offices that are serving as meal sites, and yet we know that's where the children are. So let's give her a really big hand. Thank you for sharing that great information and inspire others. Let's figure out how to make that happen more.
So while our special guest comes in and is going to be stationed right over here to take pictures, I just wanted to let you all know of one more contest that we're running again this year. It's already launched. It's our contest again for our middle and high school students. And it is this year looking for promotional ideas. So you saw our little dance up here. So we're looking for other possible dances that we can come up with Ray. We're looking for jingles and a rap. And we're looking for dance and skits and PSAs. So if your district or your county has not gotten involved already, those entries are due April the 6th at 5 p.m. So go back and make sure they know about it. But before we end and before we move on, I want to give a hand to all the summer sparks that you just heard.